You and I have something in common. We both love reptiles, but there are certain species you'll never see in my collection. So today, let's go over the top 5 species I would never own and 5 of their close substitutes. My name's Adam, this is Diamond, you're watching Wiccan's Wicked Reptiles. Stick around. I was hoping to have Pikachu out for this one, but I found him roaming around the rack. He got out and pushed a bunch of bins out, and nobody escaped. So anyway, I put a picture of it on Patreon. Let's get into the list here. 5 of the species that I would never, ever keep, and 5 of their close substitutes that I will certainly keep one day. Starting off with number 5, green tree pythons. I love green tree pythons. I think they're absolutely amazing, but I'll never keep one. Probably. Just because unless I really get into these really cool constrictor type species that are super arboreal and green and I want all of them, I would just much rather have an emerald tree boa. And to be more specific, an Amazon basin emerald tree boa. Now, no, I am not super duper rich, which is why I don't already have one. They are super expensive, but here's why I would rather keep one over a green tree python, which, although not cheap, is a little bit more affordable. Green tree pythons are green and they hang out in the trees, but they're only about 5 feet long. And if I'm getting something that is green, hangs out in the trees and looks beautiful and I can't touch anyway because they're known for being pretty defensive, I'm gonna get something that's a little bit bigger, more impressive, has a cooler pattern, like the emerald tree boa the Amazon basin version has. They have an amazing dorsal pattern. It's ridiculous, and these things might be one of the most beautiful snakes that is not venomous that there is, period. And an Amazon basin is gonna get to like 9 feet, 7 to 9 feet. They're bigger by quite a bit. We're talking about almost double the size, and they are a little bit girthier, and especially for something that hangs out in the trees, you don't really see girthy snakes that much. I don't know, they just feel much more substantial. They just seem like they're a little bit more, I don't know, my style. And at the end of the day, that's what this is, a totally biased opinion, right? I also hear, it is reported, I don't know if it's 100% true, that the Amazon basins are a little bit more, well, you can handle them. They're a little bit more tolerant to handling than a green tree python or just a regular emerald tree boa, which is gonna be about the same size, right? So no big difference there between regular emerald tree boas and the green tree pythons. Just the Amazon basins are, they're special. Everybody knows it. If you have one in your collection, it's kind of like an, oh my gosh, I can't believe you have one type of thing. They do have ridiculously large teeth. So it would still be probably a display animal and like something that is, I would imagine I'd get like a closet and make the closet and put a glass door on it. And it'd have to be pretty big, right? A 9 foot type of snake that hangs out in the trees. You need something that you're probably not gonna be able to buy from, you know, your local pet store. Oh yeah, and I always like to throw a fun fact in there. They eat using gravity. Well, all of them do, but a bigger animal eating bigger prey using gravity like this is super cool to me. Number 4. African rock pythons. Well, if you know anything about African rock pythons, there's very little explaining I need to do. They're cantankerous and they're huge. They're Africa's largest snake. In fact, there's 2 different subspecies, the northern and the southern, and no matter what you get, they're big and they're angry. And they're illegal a lot of places too. Not where I live, but they are illegal, right? New Brunswick, we all heard about that story in 2013, and now in most of Canada, right? They're basically illegal a lot of places. But what I would get instead is something I already have, a Burmese python. They look so similar. There have been posts on Facebook where I've been made a fool because someone posts an African rock python and I talk about how nice their berm is. Just because I don't look super close, I just kind of scroll and I see it. They look very similar. Now, it is distinct. If you look at them, you can tell the difference for sure. And if you're up close to them, you'll tell the difference because one doesn't really mind being handled all that much. An African rock python will, it'll huff and puff and blow your house down. And by blow your house down, I mean sink its giant teeth into you if they can. Now, don't get me wrong, African pythons are not demons, right? They're not like Satan sausages or anything like that, but they definitely aren't as great of pets as Burmese pythons. And some people will say, and I kind of agree with this, that Burmese pythons have been bred in captivity for a while. You can't really bring them into the US anymore. If we're, you know, I know most of the audience is in the US since 2012. So anything that is a baby since 2012 has either been captured from Florida or somewhere like that, or it's been captive bred, most likely. African rock pythons, there's not really as much breeding going on, not right now anyway. From what I understand, the more generations of captive breeding, the easier they are to handle, they're less cantankerous. But, I mean, Burmese pythons are cheaper, they're easier to find. Well, maybe not cheaper, but they're definitely easier to find. There are way more morphs available. I don't know of any African rock python morphs that are readily available. And Burmese pythons are personally my favorite large constrictor. They're known as the gentle giants of the constrictor world. They do get a little bit bigger. African rock pythons, 12-ish, 13 feet, something like that, where berms, females can regularly get 15 foot and beyond. So to me, I just think that it's a better pet if you're getting a giant snake. Burmese pythons, in my opinion, are the best ones. All right, number three, going from Africa's largest snake to Australia's largest snake, scrub pythons. This is a hard one for me to put on the list because I am partial to the way that they look. Of all the constricting snakes, I think scrub pythons are probably my favorite to look at because they look so unique. They're amazing. Their coloration, their pattern, their head scales, to me, they look like art. They're my favorite to look at of the large snakes, and they are one of the six largest snakes in the entire world. There's been reports of these guys being 27 foot long. I think the biggest one that was actually confirmed was in 1953 by someone who worked for Guinness or went on to work for Guinness World Records or something like that at around 24 feet. So they do get big, but usually under 20 foot is where you'll see them. Now these guys come from Australia. That's where you get the really big ones. And then they come from New Guinea and Indonesia also. And they are an arboreal snake. So we're talking about giant snakes that are arboreal. I like giant snakes. I like arboreal snakes. So why wouldn't I get one? To me, they're just a little bit too much, too big. I just don't have the space for them. I don't ever suspect I will have the space for them. And their teeth are gnarly, and they're not really known for being super predictable. Again, not demons or anything. They take a lot of work, a lot more work than other giant snakes like berms, which I have. And I think that I don't know if I'm the right guy to have one, right? Will I go to someone's collection and handle them? 100%. Will I ever own one? Probably not. Instead, what I'd own is an Eastern Indigo snake, which is not similar at all. They don't come from the same part of the world at all, but Australia's largest snake, or longest snake anyway, is a scrub python, and you're gonna go after my ear, don't do it. And North America's longest colubrid is an Eastern Indigo snake. We're talking about sometimes you'll see them north of 8.5 feet. Normally, they're not gonna get that big. They'll probably top out around 8, but they can get larger, and they're thick. These are thick like a milkshake, I am telling you. You know what else they are? Expensive. Yeah, I've got champagne taste, and I am not rich, so this is for like down the road, for sure. Another thing that they are, very smart. Ridiculously smart. When people talk about the smartest snakes in the world, they always bring up these animals, right? And this is a part two, so I did a video like this last summer, and in that video I put reticulated pythons, which are also very smart. The thing is with both species is they can be kind of fast and can be kind of unpredictable. But to me, why I would have this and I put them with the scrub python is just because they are very unique, not super common, and very expensive snakes. And if I had to get one or the other, I would get the smaller colubrid that is kind of, well, it's not arboreal, right? It's gonna be found on the ground most of the time. Easier to house, cheaper to house, easier to find, cheaper to buy, and they're cool. I mean, who doesn't like an Eastern Indigo snake? Number two, bull snakes. Now, why the heck wouldn't I get a bull snake? Well, honestly, this is just because everybody and their brother has one. And if I wanted something that was a large type of, well, we just went over a really large type of colubrid from North America, but let's suppose I wanted a large type of colubrid that looked very cool and wasn't from North America. Well, then I would get a cribo, probably a yellow-tailed cribo, because in my opinion, they look the coolest, although black tails are pretty awesome also. And yes, I know you can find them in parts of Mexico. Usually it's like the, you know, bottom part of Mexico and into Central and South America is where you're gonna find these guys. They're big. I mean, we're talking about, you know, 6 to 8 feet, something like that, for really big ones, usually 6 feet. But they're pretty thick. They are pretty fast. They are very intelligent. They move differently than a lot of other species of snake, which is something that I like. But also that, oh man, you're gonna go after my ear, stop it. But that yellow tail to me, just the difference, kind of the contrast between the body and the tail is unique amongst snakes. It's something that I really, really like. Also, cribos are known for being really good eaters. So that's something that I like also, being that I have several ball pythons and they're pain in my arse a lot of the time when they don't eat. You don't really have to worry about that with most of the snakes that I've talked about so far in the list. Bull snakes are great. They have lots of morphs. I think they're amazing. I love looking at them. I just personally don't really have much interest in actually owning one. You know, they're another one. They'll huff and puff and blow your house down. And cribos aren't known for being the most handleable, but I just think that they look cooler in my opinion, right? You like purple, I like orange, whatever. You know what I'm talking about, right? Everyone has a personal taste. My personal taste is, as I have a purple background and a purple shirt, so good. My personal taste are cribos opposed to bull snakes, although they're both awesome. All right, number one species of reptile I would never own, venomous snakes. Now, I put this on the first list, but I changed my mind a little bit because on the first list I did last summer, which actually was Diamond's first video, so how about that? I put on that first list venomous altogether, so venomous snakes and lizards. But I think I would actually own a Gila Monster, or Gila Monster, I guess it's pronounced, or a Beaded Lizard. I think I probably would, just simply because they're not so fast, right? Like if you get yourself something really cool, like a small type of arboreal viper or an elapid or something like that, they're pretty quick and I don't really trust myself. I'm not getting a forest cobra, you know? I'm not getting a king cobra, they're too big. I just feel like they are above my pay grade. They're above my skill level and I don't want to get bit by venomous snakes. I don't want my family to. I don't want them to get out. It's just kind of a headache that I don't want. If I had a facility with a staff and someone who was trained and I had access to anti-venom, wham bam, Bob's your uncle, Fran's your aunt. I got myself a whole collection of venomous snakes. But me in my house, I'm not getting venomous snakes. Now, if I live somewhere where it was legal to get a Gila Monster, which it's not here, I'm pretty sure beaded lizards are also out, but you guys know I'm trying to move south of the border. So once I move there and they have a much more relaxed set of laws, I might get myself a beaded lizard because they're cool, or Gila Monster. They do pack a wallop if they bite you, but they are slower than most species of venomous snakes and they're not gonna kill you. Oh yeah, you're gonna have a ruined day. It's gonna be real bad. We all watched that episode of Coyote Peterson getting bitten by a Gila Monster. Not a good time, but you're not gonna die. And in my experience anyway, as today I walked down and I had an escape snake, which was probably my fault, not a big deal, everyone's fine. If I had an escape snake with a venomous snake, it's a much bigger deal and they're much more likely to escape. With a Gila Monster, they're not climbing up stuff, they're a little bit less nimble, you're gonna find them on the ground most likely, and it's very unlikely that they'll escape where snakes are, well, they're sneaky snakes.
I'm a slithery little snake snake.
So there you go. Those are my five I will never ever get type of species and the five close substitutes that I would. What do you think? Are there anything on here that you think, I would have that 100%? Why wouldn't you? Is there something on here that shouldn't be on here? Let me know in the comments section. I'd really appreciate it. If you haven't already, please hit subscribe and hit a thumbs up. It costs you $0 and it helps this channel immensely. It's incredible. And a special thank you to the Patreon supporters. It was one of you guys who chose this idea, actually. You guys get extra videos, videos early, right? You get discounts on the merch. I posted pictures of the escape snake, so if you want to see stuff like that, my breeding plans I'm putting on there for as little as $1 a month, you can see all that and more, and Diamond and I would really appreciate it. The more Patreons that we have, the more bugs we get to feed Diamond. Just kidding, it doesn't matter. He gets bugs all the time anyway. Diamond actually told me that if you sign up for Patreon today, he'll eat his salad and not poop on it. So there's some motivation. Okay, that's enough. I think I've rambled absolutely as much as I possibly should. Please hit subscribe and I'll see you on, what day is it today? I always do this. Stop biting my ear. I'll see you on Thursday. Monday. I'll see you on Monday.